talk about an internal marketing model. We've talked about pest, which is the macro environment, right? Mm-hmm. We've talked about the micro environment, which is competitors, customers, suppliers, distributors. And now we're going to talk about the what's inside the company, how you align, fit together the key foundational elements of marketing inside the business. Got it? Okay, and then we'll talk about how you take pest, the macro environment, the micro environment, and the marketing elements inside the business and put them together to form a strategy to keep up with the changes in the environment. Okay? The model is simple to understand. It's very hard to practice, as you'll see when we talk about some of the business cases. M is for mission. Every great marketing strategy and every great company has a great mission. And the mission, as Peter Drucker said many years ago, just answers the question why. Why do you even have a business? What is the purpose of your existence? Okay? So it's from inside the company, looking out. It's what's your purpose for existing? Why do you exist? Got it? V is for value. Value is from the consumer's point of view. It's from outside the business looking in. And it answers the question, what? What value do I get in exchange for giving you my money? You're asking people to take money out of their pockets. I have no money, you know that, in my pockets, because my wife never gives me any. But every business is asking you to take money that you've worked hard for and give it to them. And I don't give anybody my money unless I'm getting something valuable in return. So what is the value from the outside consumer perspective that they expect when they give you money for a product or service? Target answers the question, who? Who most appreciates your value? Who's going to be most motivated to give you money? Who's going to remain a loyal customer? Who's going to promote you to all their friends? Okay, that's your target consumer audience. And the most important part of this model, developed by one of our famous marketing students, Yuan Wen, is what's in the gap? In other words, does your mission fit with the value proposition? We call it a value proposition. I am proposing to you that you give me money in exchange for what? Okay? Does your mission fit with your value proposition? Does that fit with your target market? If so, then you have a successful strategy, which is just a four-piece strategy, right? It's a strategy about product, place, price, and promotion. Okay, well, that's the theory. Sounds easy. It's extremely difficult to do. It's so difficult that half the Fortune 500, you know what I mean if I say Fortune 500? The 500 biggest companies in the world. Half the companies on that list have disappeared in the last 30 years. Gone. At the rate that companies are failing today, half the list will be gone in the next 12 years. I mean, it's a frightening world out there for businesses, primarily because they can't fit these four things together. Well, let's talk about some examples. Let's start with mission statement. I put some mission statements up on the board. These are real mission statements for real businesses. First one, guided by relentless focus on our five imperatives, we will constantly strive to implement the critical initiatives required to achieve our vision. In doing this, we will deliver... I'm tired of reading. Can you read the rest of it? Got it? Okay. That's a real mission statement. Second one, we seek to develop the most creative, innovative, and profitable entertainment experiences and related products in the world. Third one, it tells you that they put the name of the business in their mission statement. Mission of Southwest Airlines is dedication to the highest quality of customer service delivered with a sense of warmth, friendliness, individual pride, and company spirit. Next one, when it absolutely, positively has to be there overnight. And the last one, this is a quote from a person. The mission statement of the business is, we exist to make friends between humans and technology. Take a look at those. Tell me which ones you like, which one you like best, which one you like least, and why. Answering the question why. You know me, I will wait for an answer. I will not give my opinion until you say something.
Well, my favorite is the fourth one. I don't like the first one.
Okay, you don't like the first one, why?
It's too long to read.
What's wrong with long? Business is complicated. There's a lot involved in business today. What's wrong with long?
If you can speak your company mission yourself in a short sentence, that means your mission is too complicated to reach, right?
Too complicated to what?
To achieve.
To achieve. Ah! Who's got to achieve your company mission? Who's got to execute your mission? If it's your company, is it you alone, your responsibility? You make the company successful or not?
Teamwork
between how many people in your company? 50%?
100%.
Okay. If this is a global company, Albertsons is the name of the company. They're a big grocery shopping business, okay? And they have failed. They're one of the Fortune 500 that is not on the Fortune 500. Because they were actually acquired, bought by another company called SuperValu. But yeah, Yuan, you're right. It's too complicated. If you have a global company, let's say FedEx, the company I work for, you've got 200,000 employees around the world, and 200,000 people read this, they all going to understand it the same way?
No.
Well, of course not. So they're going to behave the same way? They're going to treat the customer with the same priorities? They're going to make the same kind of decisions? Of course not. They're all going to think a different value, okay? There's going to be all this confusion and inconsistency, and if your employees are confused, who's confused?
Customer.
So customers weren't sure what the value was of Albertsons because the employees weren't sure, so they quit going. They didn't know if they were going for quality or price. And look how confusing it is, by the way. I highlighted some things. They talk about five imperatives. Critical initiatives. I don't know how many critical initiatives there are, but there's five. I know there's five imperatives. Then they talk about their vision. Then they talk about many constituencies. Then they talk about long-term strategy. Then they talk about short-term tactical plans. Then they talk about their list of core values. You put all those lists together, you got to have 20 or 30 things there. You know, it's impossible for anybody to have a clear sense of why that business exists. And so you don't have teamwork, you don't have a consistent level of understanding of the value you're supposed to deliver the customer, so the customers quit coming. That's the common experience among the Fortune 500. Okay, you like four because...
It's short.
It's who? It's...
Short.
It's short, and you know, what company is it from? Smartly.
Mm-hmm.
No. We make friends between humans and technology. Apple. This is the quote from Steve Jobs. Steve Jobs never put a mission anywhere at Apple. They finally put one on their website, but it's hidden in the financial section, but it's not a mission statement, it's the history of the company. He would never put a mission anywhere on the wall. You go in most companies' mission statements everywhere because they're too complicated. You have to remind people what they are. But he didn't need to put a mission statement anywhere at Apple because the mission was obvious. It was in the hearts of people. And he said before he died, this was, you know, he never talked about it until near his death. And he thought, well, maybe I ought to tell people what was in, why I started the company. And what I made sure everybody understood was the mission of the company. Make friends between humans and technology. Awesome design, legendary ease, easy to use, beautiful to look at. That's Apple, right? I have friends that work at Microsoft. They try to make things as complicated as possible. They're all technical people, right? They talk to me, I know. They sit around and think, how much code can we write? How complicated can we make this code? Yeah, we put 5 million bytes in this program. And then it gets out to me, and it crashes, and what can I do? Nothing. Hey, I think that just happened today. Is Microsoft successful? Sure. But they have a completely different mission and value and target market. And everybody in Microsoft is clear on it. Or at least used to be. Okay, when it absolutely positively has to be there overnight is FedEx. The great company I used to work for. And Southwest Airlines, you guys have done a case on. It's simple. Quality, service, on time, and great friendly people. You couldn't make that any simpler, which is why Southwest is the only airline that's been profitable for 30 years in the United States and is one of the 5 most successful companies in the world over the past 20 years. As is Apple, of course, by the way. Okay, let's move on and talk about value a little bit, and then look at some ads, and let you analyze the ads and try to see how people put all this together to motivate the consumer to give them money, and see if you think they do a good job or not. Value is, from the consumer's perspective, people weren't sure what the value was at Albertsons. The employees weren't sure, so they quit giving money. FedEx. When it absolutely positively has to be there overnight. I'm the consumer. What's the value I'm getting from FedEx? Why am I giving FedEx my money?
Time.
Safe. Speed.
Assured.
Yeah. Yeah. That's it, I think, right? Now, what's interesting is I happen to be at FedEx. You know, I went to work at FedEx in 1981 when I was in graduate school. Then I stayed there until I got 12 years to senior leadership position. And I know what happened when the company was young. That wasn't the mission when we first started FedEx. Because you have to be careful. You may have a great mission. You may have a noble mission. It may save the world. But the consumer outside your business will never have the same perception that you have inside your business. And that's a problem with business people. They sit around in their offices and talk to each other. Oh, you man, that's a great model. That's a great idea. Let's go do that. They never talk to the customer. They never bother to get the perception from outside. We thought the value for FedEx in the consumer's perception was speed. Because we had an entirely new business model. UPS had been moving with trucks, so if you wanted to get a package from New York to Los Angeles, 3 days, maybe. And here we're saying, you give us in New York a package at 5 at night, we'll have it in Los Angeles 8 the next morning. Time is money in the U.S., right? We thought, wow, people really got to see a lot of value in that. But consumers started thinking, that had never been done before. So they started thinking, geez, if I give these crazy FedEx people my box and it's going from New York to Los Angeles in a few hours, what's going to happen? Remember, this had never been done in the history of business. I'm telling you to give me your precious jewelry, your ring, that your very handsome boyfriend gave you. And you're going to send it from New York to Los Angeles because your finger is smaller and he's got to change the size. And it's always been 3 days. And I say, hey, I can get it there in a few hours. You're going to think, huh? Something's wrong. That's all you're doing.
Are you kidding me?
That's what people thought. Now, we could put up a commercial and go out and explain our business model, but that'd take 10 minutes, and people would quit looking after 5 seconds, you know? That we can't go out and explain how we're going to do it. But that's exactly what they thought. Thank you. What's wrong with this picture? You're doing something tricky, you know? My box is, the plane's going to crash. The people driving the trucks, they've got to drive 100 miles an hour. They're going to crash. My ring's going to be smashed. It's going to be lost. It's going to end up in Canada. God only knows what can happen. So from the consumer's value perception, the value, the most important value was? Yeah. So we put in two words, we changed the mission. We put in the words absolutely and positively. Something's got to be wrong? No, we're telling you, not maybe, not even 80-90%, but absolutely positively. What's the difference in the meaning of those two words? They mean the same thing or something different?
Absolutely,
what they said. Yeah, I mean, I don't know what the difference in absolutely. I will absolutely meet you at 12 o'clock tomorrow for lunch. I will positively meet you at 12 o'clock tomorrow for lunch. Does that mean the same thing? Sure. Now, how stupid a company is this? To put two words in a short mission statement that only has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, only has 9 words, and two of the words mean the same thing. How simple and stupid can these people be? They're really smart. You see what I'm saying? We got out of the office and started talking to the consumers and started to look at the value from the consumer's perception. Got it? Okay, target market. Now, you've got a mission. You've got the value from the consumer's perspective. Now, who do you want to sell to? I want to sell to everybody in the world. I want to be rich. I want to be famous. I want everybody to buy my product. You like my strategy? Will I be successful?
You're not Coca-Cola.
What?
You're not Coca-Cola.
I'm not Coca-Cola. Why not?
It's right.
Mm-hmm.
Because Coca-Cola's target, you know, is all people. But as a company, another company, you need to segment your target, right?
Because?
Because your mission and value is different.
Different for who?
From Coca-Cola company.
Okay. And how old is Coca-Cola? That's my answer too. They're so old, nobody knows. Nobody cares. They're ancient, you know? They're not even old, they're ancient. They're like ancient Middle Eastern history. You know, the cradle of civilization. I think the first man and woman had a Coke. I could be wrong, but that's, I would bet you on it. So when Coke started, or McDonald's started, there was no soft drink but Coke. There was no fast food but McDonald's, right? When Henry Ford made the first automobile, he made the only automobile. So there was no competition then, right? People drank Coke, and it's the only soft drink they had for years and generations in their family. So they captured all, not all, but we could say they captured most. You know, their target was huge, right? Well, has the world changed any since Coke and McDonald's and Ford? A little or a lot? Oh, my gosh. My great-grandmother rode a horse. I actually heard her talk about this one time, the first car. She rode a horse. She went about 5 miles an hour. She got hot when it was hot. She got wet when it rained. She got cold when it snowed. Henry Ford comes along with the car. There's no choice in the car. You get a black car, that's the only color. Guess what color the inside is?
White?
No. Too expensive. Black. Guess what color the tires are?
Black.
Black. The only thing on the car that wasn't black was the bumper. Now, you think she wanted a car? Go about 5 times faster, not hot, not wet, not cold. How many people wanted a car from Henry Ford?
Many.
Yeah, there you go. It's the same as you said before. Everybody, right? You want a horse or a car? You want a horse or a black car? Who's buying my horse? I give you my horse. Please take my horse. You going to take my horse or the car?
Car.
Ah. Now today I tell you, hey, you want to buy a car? I got the car for you. You have no choices. The outside's black. The inside's black. The radio's black. The engine's black. You going to buy my car? Huh? Oh, that's good. Yeah, how many car companies today? I don't know, too many to count. Every one of those companies has hundreds of color combinations. You can get white, red, and black on the outside. Red, white, and blue on the inside. You know, you can get all kinds of different radios. You can get cars that go fast, cars that save gas, right? So the world has changed since Coke and Henry Ford. No choices to more choices, you know what to do with. So now you had better understand your consumer. Because the consumer can afford to get what they want. So you better understand who is most motivated to give you money for your value. Because if you don't, somebody else will steal that consumer for you. Now here's an example. We're obviously going to work a lot more on this. McKinsey did some research on China's wealthy people. And these are their words. Chinese wealthy are very different. They have 7 different segments. And we've talked about segments. Yuan Yuan mentioned that. Segments, you divide up the market using certain criteria, demographic, psychographic, behavioral, and then you choose a target that best appreciates your value, will be most motivated to give you money. They divided just the wealthy. I've had many people say, well, that's a good target. Wealthy people in China. No, that's not a target. Because wealthy people in China aren't the same. Yeah, they're very different. They came up with 7 different segments just among the wealthy. These are just 3, but just look at the top 2. You have urban people, a little lower than average, but they're wealthy. They live in tier 1 cities. They're mostly men. They care about health, environment, quality of family life. You have climbers, people trying to get up to the top. They're already wealthy, but they want to be more wealthy. What do they care about? Health, environment, family? No, they care about status. Okay? They're going to buy a fake Gucci bag. Right? Because they want to look like they belong. People on the top going to buy fake or real?
Real.
Only real. Okay? There's a tremendous difference just between those two. In other words, they are looking for completely different value. They are motivated by completely different things. Now, when you understand which part, which segment of the market most appreciates your value, then you can target them, and then you can talk to them. You know, we'll use Maslow. I know you know Maslow. Then you know which one level, not 2, not all 5, which one level of needs in Maslow's hierarchy you use to communicate, to promote to them, because that's where they're motivated. Status or family, that's a world of difference. That's completely different levels, right? Okay, enough lecture. I'm going to give you some examples, short, simple examples of people trying to get this work together, trying to market, to promote the value of their mission to a target audience. And I'm going to ask you to rate it in two groups. On one, clarity. In other words, when you look at this promotion, is the value and the target market very clear? You say, well, hey, they're trying to sell this value to these people. Okay, it's really clear to you what the value is and who the target market is. And secondly, I'll ask you to evaluate consistency. In other words, in your groups, do you all consistently interpret the value and the target as the same? Or does everybody see different value and a different target market? Got it? Because obviously you want people to be clear, and you want everybody who looks at your promotion to consistently interpret it the same way. Right? Okay. You know what I'm going to show you first? I will show you first the prize-winning international promotion made by your friends. Well, some of you know them. Students here, okay? Mm-hmm. They won the prize for best promotion in my class. So I'm going to put their promotion up against some ones that millions of dollars were spent on. Okay? And we'll see how I want you to be fair. Just rate theirs compared to the others. This one, by the way, I required them to do it with no words. Okay? The others, one of them will have no words and one words. So this is a no-word promotion by international students.
Thank you.
two print ads. No words, no music. Got it? Enough? Oh, I just like looking at that FedEx logo. I'll take it. You know stare, right? You know stare? You mean no? Look. Look because it's so beautiful. Keep looking. Cannot take your eyes off away. Like your boyfriend, you know? Got it? Okay. So work in your groups and rate those four. Okay, on how clear and how consistent, and then we'll see what you think and talk about it and finish. Okay? Okay, so FedEx is, you give it a number or just say it's best?
Best.
Okay. So FedEx is best. Worst is?
Fear.
Fear. Worst. Worst. Okay, best and worst because? Best because I work there? Good. Best because?
Because, you know, when they see the picture, we know it's a delivery company. Right?
Okay.
Second is, from this state to another state, it's a long distance.
Right.
Yeah? And just like, send a package from upstairs to downstairs.
Ah! Now I'm going to use some more of your words in my other class. I never, that's, yeah. The two countries are?
It's so far.
They're sending in between what countries?
Like,
I think that's China to Australia.
China to Australia, yeah. But it's this fast,
yeah.
And this safe.
Yeah.
It could not be faster or safer, right?
Yeah.
Okay. And the beer, you don't like the beer because?
I don't know, the beer advertisement until the last minute.
She doesn't drink.
That's a good reason. Well, what do you think the value of, what is the value they're trying to communicate? Well, why should I give them my money? Try their beer. I don't know. Honestly, I'm not sure. So I'm asking to see. I'm always curious.
The beer, I think, is wait for, it's worthwhile to wait for.
It is, yeah.
Beer.
But do you know why it's worth waiting for?
I don't.
What do you, you're the guy, what, you have any understanding about what they're trying, the value they're trying to communicate in the beer?
In my perspective, I don't think that advertisement is good, because if I want to have a drink for the beer, I will think about their taste and the price.
Yeah.
So I do not wait, I do not want to wait to purchase a beer. I just want to go to the store and find.
Yeah. So, okay, thanks. And I don't want to wait 1 minute to even know it's about beer. And then I'm trying to think, well, what did it say? But that's just me. All right, we'll talk. Best is?
Using the finance and the beer very good.
The best is?
Best is beer.
Beer?
Yeah.
Oh, my God. Beer is the best, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
And the worst is iPhone.
And the worst is that.
Okay.
Now this always happens with the beer commercial, no matter the class. This is why I use it. The beer commercial is best because?
I think, yeah, you know, for me as a girl, I don't understand the beer totally, but our group has three.
Right. The beer is best because?
They understand totally what the advertising talking about.
Okay.
So I think they told me that they can demonstrate a chemical linkage and relationship with the people. You know, from beginning to the end, just a rival. different level of people share with each other. So you even didn't know what happened at the end of the level. So once you understand what's going to happen, the advertising is going to influence it. You're going to remember
okay.
it.
All right, guys that drink beer, what do you think?
Naturally, I think...
Just in a word or two.
We are divided between beer and FedEx. For me, I think FedEx, the beer is the best.
Okay. But you are not consistent about which is the best. You're divided on the beer. That every class is divided on the beer. Or if I'm talking consulting with executives, they're divided. You cannot be more divided than best and worst. Is this a good thing if you put a promotion out? And you have people saying, wow, best, and other people saying worst. It's not very clear communication, is it?
And another thing about the beer, for example, when they are showing the objective in drinking beer, because when we drink a beer, it is for enjoyment. And in the advertising, they are showing there is a link between people in different areas. So that's the reason why we really think the advertising is good.
It's amazing. Everybody who looks at it sees something else. See, I see the enjoyment, but they are enjoying the burning the cars. They're not enjoying the beer. So I want to go out and burn some cars. You know, I want to go out and build the big domino thing in Dalian. But everybody sees something different, you know. It's amazing. Millions of dollars, and they have not been consistent in what people see. All right, the worst is? Because?
Just
very dull.
And very unclear.
Nothing boring the animation.
Not what?
Nothing boring the animation.
They just show the picture of iPhone and it says that it's okay to stare.
Yeah.
But even though it's not completely expressing what Apple is about, who is it for, it's just a picture for Apple.
And there's nothing to stare to.
It's good. See, I need to be worth it to have you guys here. Now, okay, we have to finish in just 5 minutes, but think about this. The Apple print ad, that is a sign of a business becoming what? The Apple print ad is a sign of a business becoming too over
confident.
Okay? Apple, just for the first time at the World Technology Conference just last month, every year iPhone wins the best phone. This year, Samsung won it with Galaxy. Okay? First time in years. You see what's happening? You get so successful, then you get sloppy. You can make no mistake. You don't have to pay attention to the model. We're better than the model. What are we going to worry about this simple, you know, fit things together? We're Apple. As soon as you try to trick the model, what does the consumer do to you? Punish you. Okay? It happens every time. There are no business people smarter than Apple. If they can't trick the model, you'll never trick it. Okay? You get overconfident. You get a little cute, you know. Oh, let's do this. That'd be cool. Stare. People say, huh? And meanwhile, Samsung's got this cycle working great now. Okay. Yeah, the FedEx ad won a big marketing award for the best ad for the year. Now think, the beer commercial. I forgot the number. It was many millions of dollars they spent to make that commercial. Okay, this is a picture. You know, this is a picture and the person got on the computer. This is one person in 1 hour could make this. Maybe $100. I don't know. It's not millions of dollars. This won an award. Everybody who looks at this sees the same thing. Okay? The same value. Fits with the mission. If I want to get a package from China to Australia, and it's really important, and it absolutely positively has to be there the fastest, I don't have anything to think about. You know, I'm going to send it FedEx. But that's me. Okay, those are good observations, and you're adding to my research. I'm waiting for one class to be consistent on the beer commercial interpretation. And it has never happened. So many millions of dollars, you know? So many cars hurt. Probably some people burned. That's what I want to know. I actually think some people died while they were making this commercial. They just didn't show it. See, some of it's dangerous. Okay. All right, we're going to finish.
How about this?
All right, two PPTs, and we finish, okay? Very simple question. The one thing I ask students, why do you want to go into business? Why do you want to go and be in management? Why do you want to be a marketing vice president? And the word I hear most often is
money.
Okay. Today, have we mentioned the word money? I don't know that you said the word, much less talked about it. Now, this is dangerous, isn't it? A business cannot survive without profit, without money, and we haven't even talked about money. Oh, we have wasted a whole 1 hour lecture. Yeah? Huh? Yeah, is money important to business?
If you follow the model, the money will come.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, I know it's obvious, but I want you to say it. If you follow the model, the money will come in, and if you don't follow it, you can think about money all day, you can never sleep and think about money, and you're never going to make any, right? Quick story, and then talk about Apple results. Fred Smith, I was lucky to go to work for a great company and a great CEO. Fred Smith started FedEx. He's still the CEO of FedEx. He's taken it through all these environmental crazy changes, global recessions, going international. And the company's boring. It makes so much money. You know, so you never hear about the success of FedEx because every year they just make money. The first class I was in when I was only 23 and I became a manager at FedEx, Fred Smith came into the class. He walked in and I swear the first thing, I will never forget this, even when I am old and my brain is dead, I'd still be able to tell you. That impression was that strong. He walked up to the front of the class. He didn't say hello. He said, if you're going to be successful at FedEx, I want you to never think about money or profit. I'm a 23-year-old kid. I'm like, what is this man, nuts? How did he build a great company? You know, what do you mean never think about profit? That's the only thing we're supposed to think about. And then he looked at us and asked a question. I think I've asked you this before. He said, is breathing important to you? Is breathing important to you? It is? Very important. Very important. You sure? Ah, very important. Then I guess you think about breathing all the time. Huh? How much do you think about breathing?
You don't know.
I beg your pardon?
You don't know this, your breathing.
You never think about breathing? I thought you said it was very important.
Only if when you got choked and then that you want to breathe. Okay,
but you're not thinking about it every day, all the time? But you're going to die if you don't breathe. Why aren't you thinking about breathing? This makes no sense to me. I don't see how you are alive. You're going to die in 1 minute. You better think about breathing. I don't want to call the ambulance for you. How can you not thinking about breathing, but it's very important? I don't understand.
It's a habit that becomes like nature to you. You don't simplify it.
All right, thank you. That's what he said about business. He said, money is like breathing. It's not only very important, you have to have it, but it's natural. Okay? You put this together, you can't stop making money. You know? It's as natural as you being alive because you're breathing. But you stop thinking about this, and you can think about money, and just like you think about breathing if you're dying, and you're going to die if you're choking. Okay? You can think, breathe, 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 but if you're choking, you're dead. And I've never forgotten that, and that's why FedEx is such a great company. Now, it's not just FedEx. Apple is this slide, and then just what Steve Jobs says about it, and we're finished. This is January 23, this year. This is Apple today announced financial results, another record. Okay, in 3 months, they had $54 billion You know how many zeros that is? How many zeros? 54 and how many zeros? 9. Okay, 9. And a record profit. Now, big sales is okay, but profit is the breathing, okay? Record profit of $13 billion. They made more profit in 3 months than the size of their competitive companies. You understand what I'm saying? They made more profit in 3 months than the annual year-long sales of their competition. Because Steve Jobs never thought about money. You can look at all his interviews, you can read his books, okay? He never talked about it. Here's what he said, and then we're through. And I'll leave you with this, but I highlighted some words. These are quotes in Business Week and an interview he did before he died, where people said, listen, open up and talk about, you know, how in the world did Apple become this company that just nobody can compete with? And it's a big company, and then the results I showed you in 2013 were double those in 2011. 2011, Apple was still big, right? Great, successful company, but they doubled. As a big company, you can't move that fast. You can't do that in business. It's never been done. Well, Steve, how did you do it? The organization is what? Simple. My job was to make everything get simpler, focus, simplicity, simple, simple. What was Steve Jobs at, his job at Apple was to say, you guys know this. He had one word. He said, my job at Apple is to walk around and say, yes, no. Yes, no. You got it? Yes. The word is no.
No.
No. Yes. Got it? Yes, it's no. His job was to walk around and say no. To how many things? 1,000 things. Only by saying no can you concentrate. Focus, focus, focus. It means saying no, what, to bad ideas? No, saying no to 100 good ideas. He's as proud of the things he said no to and Apple never did as he's proud of what they did. Somebody comes to, Apple has genius people, you know, I've been to their headquarters. They're all smart, they have 100 ideas a day. They go to Steve Jobs and say, hey, here's a great idea. And Steve Jobs says, what? No, because there's a little problem here. Just a little problem. They're smart people, not a big problem. Just a little something doesn't fit. But Steve Jobs knows that little problem gets out in the market, and it's what kind of problem? Huge. You can't believe how huge. Okay? Here's how huge it is. Steve Jobs dies. So sad, so young. Now there's nobody at Apple to say what? Less than 1 year after he's dead, what happens? iPhone's not the best. People in the industry say it's not the best. Last quarter, their results went which way? The quarter after this. They're going to be lower. I mean, there are a lot of signs. They're all smart people, but there's nobody there to say no. Now, the foundation of marketing is this. You can say yes. You can learn how to make a great strategy. Okay? You can learn how to improve and innovate, but you can't do that until you say no. And no matter how small the problem and things don't fit together, no, that's the magic word. Thank you for all your wonderful insights. See you next time. Finished.